Welcome to the new way. Welcome to the new way. Welcome to the new way. Let's go over a little bit about how this has taken place. I'll give you a little background to the new way. And it really began on May 22nd. I fulfilled a bargain that I had made. And I said, I'm going to stick to these habits, and it was also fulfillment of a bargain that the Holy Spirit had made with me. The Holy Spirit says, you're going to be somewhere on May 22nd. Prepare for that. And I trusted it. I had faith in it. And I did prepare. And I was there. And it was just absolutely extraordinary. One of the most beautiful sights and vistas and experiences anyone's ever had in this world, actually. And I agreed not to take any video, not to take any pictures, just to experience it directly. And that's exactly what happened. And then after that experience on May 22nd, we go into June, and maybe it was like a week ago, like what's today, 11th, maybe the 6th, June 6th, June 5 or 6, I had an experience in a dream, and it was a sort of a twilight sort of dream. And I've been having this very powerful feeling, like I want to communicate with Jesus. I want to have a meeting with Jesus. And it took place. It took place in the dream. So, and in this meeting with Jesus, he didn't say anything, and I didn't say anything. It was just his presence, his presence. His presence was there, and I was aware of myself imagining a physical form for his presence. So he didn't project a physical form. I'm the one who put the physical form together in my own imagination, so I could feel like there was someone there. I was somebody there I was relating to. It was sort of reassurance for me. But he did not project any sort of a physical appearance. But it was his presence was there, and not a word was said. I just observed. I was quiet and observed. It didn't last very long. And that was it. And then from there, subsequently, a day or two afterwards, suddenly the new way dawned upon me of how to practice directly devaluing the I. Okay, now I'm able to do this, to sort of pioneer this, because of all the work with Jesus, A Course in Miracles, and then Journey Beyond Words, where Jesus emphasizes, especially in Journey Beyond Words, it is our valuing really is the central problem. And so by devaluing the notion of an I, this is getting to the very heart and very directly to our trouble. And so really what happened was the meeting with Jesus was able to induce this, somehow it induced this new way within me. It like fertilizer or something, or you know, how do you induce a plant to bloom? Put it in a greenhouse maybe, and the heat causes the flowers to bloom. So nothing was said. No words were used at all. And nothing was even implied. It was just the mere presence. The mere presence. That's all that it was. And it's becoming more apparent why, like, for instance, Ram Maharshi, they're silent, and it's just the presence that is most powerful. It induces the most powerful breakthroughs. Whereas if you try to put everything on a level of words, it's not nearly as effective. Also, my meeting with Longchenpa back in November of 2013 induced the guru vision of intrinsic spaciousness without him hardly saying anything. I did speak to him, and I said, how was your trip? And how was the water? He walked across this vast ocean. He said, well, it was both warm and cool, or something like that, right? It's both. But there was no teaching or anything. It was just he kind of the one statement. But the induction happened, right? It's the presence. It's the presence that is important. Just the presence. Like a vast magnet attracting us. Attracting our spirit. So welcome to the new way. The new way is really for very advanced teachers of God. It's not for the rest of us, probably at this point. It's too direct. It's too for most. It's probably too direct. But for those of us who are very far along, it's really the ticket home, isn't it? And it's self-selective, really. I mean, if you feel like, yeah, this is it. This is the new way, and I'm able to do this, then that's absolutely wonderful. And if you feel like, ah, no, it's too much, you won't do it. So it's okay to bring this up and put it out to the world, and those who are attracted to this will find it. Now, I was going to write it N-E-W-A, but the Holy Spirit kept insisting, no, put new, N-U. What's this? A bee? Yeah, bee is buzzing around. Ah. Being is in the house. Hello, bee. Wow. It's very intense being there. Very intense being. And, that was intense. It was right in my nose, like there. I didn't want to get stung, so I just moved with it, which is okay. It's okay to be like that. You don't have to say, sting me, bee. Because after all, we're just getting our feet wet here with the new way and moving into it. Wow. And on May 22nd, I spoke before in a previous video of this lotus pond. I was playing golf, which I hadn't played in. I've only done it once in the last year, and only a few times in a couple years. I quit altogether. But I was told I'm going to do this on that day. And I did, and I was at the course I wanted to be at. And it's a surreally beautiful course, like you're in heaven. You feel like you're in another world for sure. And so here I am going along, walking up to this hole, and I go around the bend a little bit, and there's this pond, this large pond, sparkling in the morning sun, with this dramatic backdrop of mountains and just a stupendous setting, and this pond, a beautiful, beautiful pond, and it was absolutely full of lotus flowers, of different shades. The white and the pink. The white with sort of a yellowish, goldenish tint, and the pink. And I just, I just went into prayer. And I just said, I thank God for this moment. You know, I stopped playing golf and I abandoned golf and went into prayer and thank and gratitude. I said, this is just over the top, over the top. You've outdone yourself. It was so moving. And I understood it. This is a message saying, look, the grace is going to be upon us in a most sublime way. And it took enormous effort to fulfill this promise and faith. Without any means to get there, I said, God is going to get us there some way, so I'm going to prepare. And it took place in a most unusual. God works in mysterious ways. And it was a very, very indirect and unexpected way that this was enabled. But I was able, you know, physically good enough shape, mentally good enough shape to actually do it. And so, as we talk about this new way and how it's come about, we'll continue with this theme. And I've sort of wanted to sort of stop taping. I said, you know, I got a warning in a dream that I'm going to miss the boat if I do something. And I was worried maybe it's taping. But the Holy Spirit has reassured me, no, that's not it. What it is Facebook. and social media in terms of interacting like that. And I'm absolutely feel prohibited to be doing that right now. So this, and I'm getting very strong messages that I need to work on this taping and do it. And this morning I got another strong, I said daily clarification, daily clarity. I'm supposed to give these daily updates here to help this new way go through. And it can't be done on Facebook at this point. Cannot. And so I've stayed away from that. Absolutely stayed away from it. Stayed away from, you know, any interaction like with forums and stuff. This is really for very advanced teachers of God here. Now, the Course in Miracles was for teachers of God. Jesus says, who's this course for? It's for teachers for God. It's not for everyone. And who are teachers of God? Those who choose to be so. It's very advanced, A Course in Miracles. It's extraordinarily advanced. And then we had Journey Beyond Words, which not many have paid attention to, which is just, again, much more direct and concise. Okay, much more direct and concise. So it's like a graduate course, and Dialogue on Awakening also is extraordinarily advanced and direct. And then we have this new way, which is even more direct. It's the heart of directness, actually. And that's after 23 years of studying Journey Beyond Words, which came after like about, you know, 15, at least 15 years of studying A Course in Miracles. So there's been a long time frame here of getting used to more and more and more direct approach. And the direct approach is quite stunning, quite stunning. And I seem to be, the jitters seem to be calming down now. The first week of it, I really, the last week was an extremely difficult week, and I almost had a nervous breakdown. I had an anxiety attack almost, and my nerves were just shaking. And it was really very tough, and the Holy Spirit helped me get through it. And I just said, wow, I need to, hopefully this will calm down. And I did get some good rest last night for the first time. But my sleep was very disrupted. And so it's powerful. It's like you take a powerful medicine, you feel it kick in, you say, oh my gosh, you know, this is going to be quite a ride. Back in the 60s, when people were into psychedelics and such, you know, they'd take something and they say, it's fine, nothing's happening. And then suddenly they say, wait a minute. You know, like my attention was fixated or something. Like, wait a minute, what's going on here? Things aren't quite normal. My perception is changing. What's going on? And then you have this point where you say, oh my God, you know, I'm not in Kansas anymore. And that can become rather disconcerting for a while. And then it smooths out and the full thing comes on. And they say, okay, this is, and then they start settling into it. Some of the time. And so when something this powerful takes place, there's going to be some jitters. Okay, no doubt about it. And having the responsibility to pioneer this through the meeting with Jesus and request from Jesus to help us out. I've been requesting it so powerfully, and he responded. And that Dialogue on Awakening with Tom and Linda Carpenter was pivotal. Pivotal. Because he pioneered the way of directly interacting with Jesus at this time in this very profound way, as a brother. And I got that book. As I said, we were in a place where he used to live, and I almost met him down there. But they moved on the very day that I was down there, but missed him. And so I told my wife about that, and I said, you know, it's amazing that this wonderful brother of ours, Tom and Linda Carpenter, brother and sister Tom and Linda Carpenter, they were living in the same place that we're at right now, which is where I had this tremendous experience of beauty. And she said, oh, really? Say, why, what did he do? I said, well, he wrote this book. She says, get that book. I want to read that book. Get that book. I want to read that book. So immediately I jumped on it and found a used copy and ordered it through Amazon. And it arrived very, very quickly in several days. And I don't know if she's read it, but I certainly jumped into it again. I read it back in the 90s. And that somehow helped trigger the confidence to call upon Jesus. As you know, it's time for me to meet Jesus again. I've met him many, many times, but this was way more direct. Way, way more direct. It was like no doubt about it. And he's sitting here, you know, just sitting there 4 feet away from me. And I'm sitting there and I'm looking at him and can see very clearly his focus, his presence, very, very clearly. So you might, so all these experiences I'm having, of course, it's like, wow, very, very intense, right? And then jumping on this and having the effectiveness of the new way already has hit me very strongly. So yeah, the jitters have been here over the last first week of the new way, but they've settled down. And I'm working out, keeping all my good habits, worked out a lot yesterday. And feel good, feel really good, feel strong, and that's been helpful too. When I found that when I'm really was going through a really rough spell, I was so weak, physically weak, but the overall strength of my body and flexibility and everything, I was able just to keep moving, and had confidence. And now I know that I'll bounce back from this. Whereas if I was really weak and feeble to start with, I might have really panicked. And this is part of a commitment I made almost a couple years ago, where I decided that I was going to do this. It was the end of August, 2:15, I guess you would say, 2:15, and I had been basically during the summer of 2:15, I had basically given up. I said I've done everything I can do. I don't see the results. You know, what the heck? And so I spent the summer of 2:15 just eating anything I wanted to eat. I said, I just kind of, you know, what the heck? And so I was just, every day was just as much food as I wanted to eat, anything I want, any cake, ice cream, desserts, sweets, you know, veggie hamburgers, veggie hot dogs, French fries, you know, whatever just I've wanted to, and no restrictions. And what happened was I just, you know, ballooned up in weight and like a blimp. And I said, I don't care. You know, I think my life is pretty much over anyway, so why not, you know, last meal sort of thing, right? And last meal before the execution. But then I started thinking, you know, what if I don't die? What if I don't die? Do I want to go through the rest of my life like this? And what it was I realized that if I wanted to do what I was supposed to do, I had to be very disciplined. And sort of like last call at the bar before this discipline had to kick in. And so I, at some point I realized, okay, it's now or never. Either you start discipline now, or you're not going to fulfill your role here in the world. And it was very difficult. And, you know, I just decided, you know, okay, finally, I said, wow, gotta go for it, you know. Otherwise, I'm gonna kick myself and have regrets, and I don't want to do that. And since that day, it's been nonstop. You know, we're coming up on almost 2 years of extremely strict diet, and over a year and a half of physical fitness. You know, all this, you know, every day, and just tremendous discipline over the last couple of years. With no break at all, it's been very difficult, and but you know I've done it, and this has seen me through, so that we can get this new way through. So the fruits are showing up now. And you have to be, one has to be very confident to do this, because this is really a new way. And so I put my confidence to the test. I had to really build my confidence up in so many different ways. But this, you know, it took a dip. And I was shown this by the grace of God, that I was going to go through this sort of a bumpy, short bumpy period. And that's what happened. My nerves really feel better now. They really feel better. I feel much calmer. There's still a little, you know, excitement about it. Yeah, absolutely. This is just tremendous, just tremendous. So welcome to the new way. Welcome to the new way. And we're pioneers here. So, you know, it's going to be a little ragged. Don't expect everything to be completely smoothed out like we've been doing this for 50 years or something. But on the other hand, it's better to be a pioneer because we can give ourselves some slack about it all, you know? It's not dogmatic, hasn't become dogmatic at all. We don't really know exactly what to expect, do we? No. And that's part of the great romance of this is we don't know what to expect. We don't know what the fruits are going to be, but they're going to be better than we expect. Just like on May 22nd, it just thank God I didn't bring my camera. I left my camera and video recorder at home as a promise to God, I'll do this. That was maybe the toughest decision I ever made in my life. And of course, what I experienced, what was just so extraordinary. If I had my cameras with me, for sure I would have been distracted into taking massive amounts of video and pictures, etc. And that would have actually nullified the effectiveness of it all. Because then I would have been obsessed with processing all this video and getting and working with all these images. And it's not about images and video anymore per se. It's not that that is completely precluded, no. But I find in trying to, like going back to Facebook, I was thinking images, and I feel that's the old way. That's the old way. This is the new way. Okay. We're not so much into static images anymore. We're more into the flow of the now, the flow of the now, rather than static images. Of course, Facebook is heavily, heavily into static images and text. And that's the old way. And I found in trying to see, should I go back to that? It felt so old and out of style. So old and out of style. Antiquated, actually. The whole previous epoch, you know, now seems antiquated. And prior to this, it's kind of like surfing a wave. It's immediate and now, and it's flowing. And you don't stop and say, oh, let me take a picture of myself on the wave or something. Oh, look, no, you have to really keep your balance as this wave is rapidly moving, okay? And you have to really be in the present moment and very much aware. So I can't be stopping and let me take a picture of this. Let me get some video of this and that. We're moving too fast right now. We're moving too fast for that. So we don't know exactly where we're at, except we know we're moving very fast. But if we, like I've been doing a lot of balance practice, so my balance is, I'm able to keep my balance really well, a lot of strength practice, and so I feel like, okay, well, what, you know, whatever happens, I believe I can handle it. I don't know what to expect, actually. But I have faith in it all. I have faith in the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, Jesus, and the Dharma Kings. So it's going to be way better than we expect. And that's quite a shocker as well, but we could handle it. Like that lotus pond, I was able to go with that. I just went with it and just said, wow, this time to just stop and pray in gratitude. this is you know, a lifetime moment. This is stupendously beautiful. I don't know if anyone's ever seen anything any more beautiful than that in the world, actually, in this world. It was that beautiful. I expected Padmasambhava to show up, and maybe he did. I expected to look at one of the lotus flowers and see a tiny Padmasambhava. Absolutely, I did. So this is a bit of the ideology of the new way. We're just sort of talking about it as pioneers in all this. One moment here. Okay. And we're just doing this. Where are we doing this? Where is this all happening? It's just happening here in the Bay Area, Silicon Valley, South Bay, of the Bay Area in California. And it's just a little suburban place here, right in the midst of the jungle of the Silicon Valley, the Shark Tank, as I call it. And, you know, I work really hard 40-day weeks and don't have, dollar to my name really at all. And I just have faith in the grace of God. But I'm not in a cave somewhere, in a monastery or cave at this point. Right in the midst of hectic, busy world. But I don't pay attention to the news. Hardly at all. You know, it seeps through a little bit for people saying things, etc. But at this point, I've been off of the news for years, actually. And when I took a little peek just before the new way started, a little peek at it and say, okay, all right, enough of that. And I'm off of it again, off of no TV, no movies, none of this stuff. Really boycott the gist of this world. I boycott it. I don't pay any attention to it. And, it's still there, and occasionally, stuff comes to you, but it's, 99.9%. Paid no attention to at all. It's not relevant to what we're doing. It's really not relevant. Yeah. It's really not relevant at all to what we're doing. It's not. And I was thinking if I meet Jesus again, I want to ask him, maybe I can ask him about this and this and this and this. That was prior to meeting him. And last time, about a little over a week ago, And, but he didn't say anything. So that's better, because he introduced what we really need. See, if we ask about these issues that are happening in the world and he gives answers, then we're going to want to induce the eye. Say, I need the eye to help me deal with this. And you see, so what he's doing, he's preparing us for something else. Like that lotus pond. Something sublimely beautiful, actually, is what we're being prepared for. Now, is that another world? Is it this? Is it, I don't know. But he certainly doesn't want us focusing on answers to how do we fix the world situation. He's never focused on that. None of the Dharma kings have, actually. So I just have to have faith. We let us just have faith in that yeah, we don't have answers to all these questions, right? I didn't ask a question. He didn't answer any question. It was silent. He wasn't even trying to be silent. It was just presence. And what came out of that is the new way. And again, the spelling N-U, I was insisted upon. I said, what? And then our friend here told me that new in Romanian means no. No way. So maybe that's it. Maybe that's it. No, the new way, which is no way, actually. There's no way to induce the presence of the I. There's no way to induce the presence of the I. So everything that we're doing is an attempt to induce abnormality, actually. Because the presence of the I is our desire that we change reality, which is reality is intrinsicness, I call it intrinsicness. I love that term because it there's no dogma attached to it hardly for us. If we call it the now, or if we call it this or that, there's a lot of baggage around all of that. But if we call it intrinsicness, it's sort of a very, very new way of expressing it. And I love that term, just the intrinsicness. There's only intrinsicness. And so we're trying to be greater than this intrinsicness. Spirit is. We're spirit, so to speak. And that's pretty nebulous, I know. But there's a desire to change it and be greater than that. So we can change what is the basic structure, the intrinsicness, and have an absence of intrinsicness. But there really isn't any absence of intrinsicness. So it's never happened. But we're trying to induce it. We're trying to get it to happen. We're trying to sort of be the cause of abnormality, which would be the absence of intrinsicness somewhere, somehow. There's some situation where it's absent. So this whole song and dance we're doing as a world, as a universe, as bodies, as all this, is really an attempt to induce abnormality, absence of intrinsicness, which we label I. We give this term I to that. So we're trying to induce I, this present, the presence of I. And we've never succeeded at this, but we keep, again, trying to induce it. So the beauty of this perspective is just dawning upon me, and it's so compassionate, because no one's really being judged other than just that one recognition. It removes all other judgment from everything. And if there's all other judgment removed and there's only just this recognition, there really isn't any judgment at all taking place. It's just factual, saying we're trying to induce the presence of I, and that's impossible. And that's the end of it. That's not a judgment. It's saying it's impossible to change reality. It's not a judgment. It's just a fact. But we're not judging anyone into what format they're using to try to induce presence. It's all formats are equally ineffective. Okay, they're all equally ineffective, so there's no judgment to pass on anyone. Now, we may want to steer clear of those who are dancing a dance of inducement, which we may be attracted to. We know, so whoa, I don't want to be pulled into that, so we back away from that. That's fine, but that's not an overall judgment. It's not being judgmental. You see, because we know it's merely attempt to induce the presence of a non-existent I, abnormality. That's all it is, and that's all that any of this is. The dance of perception, as we know it. The dance of what we call lives, as we know it. It's just a dance of inducement, which is totally ineffective. So it really doesn't matter how we dance the dance, and we've danced it in, innumerable ways, you might say. Because our creativity is being used in this. So I look at the younger generations and what they're doing, and it's like, what? Their dance of inducement is quite creative and quite different. But I see it, it's just the same dance of inducement is all it is. It's just there. It's very different than what we did. And what we did was very different than previous, to some extent. But I think it's a much greater difference now with the technological spin on the dance of inducement. They're doing this very kind of different dance of inducement. But I know, so it's not. So I feel like I can just say, no, it doesn't work. That's all. And no dance of inducement works. And I don't have to say, well, they're bad or they're wrong and we're right or something like that. It's not judgmental. It's just saying, no, I can see that, that won't work. It's easy to see that doesn't work. Now, for them, it's not so easy to see it doesn't work. They may think, yeah, this is going to work. This is going to work. That's why they're doing it. They have a lot of confidence that's going to work. Just like maybe we had a lot of confidence in what we were doing was going to work. Like the whole classical music phase in the world, which I was very much part of. I had a lot of confidence. We had a lot of confidence this would work. We were true believers in that. And, you know, that lasted hundreds of years. Quite a long phase. I mean, maybe, how long? 300, 400 years or so. And it's still going on, but it's petered out pretty much, you know, to a large extent. But still, there's still many people feel that this is going to do it. And again, I played a very pivotal role in all of that. I was very much part of that classical music belief that this is going to induce the presence of the eye. I was a true believer in that, and I promoted it to an extraordinary extent, an extraordinarily effective extent, actually. So, and I ended up, unfortunately, with all that karma of believing it is possible to induce the eye, but we just do it through beautiful classical music. And so that was very heavy karma, terrible, terrible. I had to walk all that back. So it's never a good thing to be a leader of an inducement movement. You pay an extremely heavy toll for that. And I have great compassion for those who are in that, have been in that position, true believers, that this style of inducement is going to work. It's got to work. This is it. You end up paying just a horrible price for that. And I certainly did. So I'm very motivated to not do that again. That's for sure. So we're directly saying there is no way to induce the presence of quote-unquote the I, which would be really what we say, the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. There's no way to induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. It's completely impossible. It doesn't matter if we keep creatively inventing styles of inducement, inducement dances, as we might call it, for you know, the next trillion to the zillionth power years or moment, you know, whatever, just, you know, all eternity, we just keep doing these inducement dances. None of them will ever work. They'll all be complete failures. And we can see this right now, so we don't need to go on with all that stuff. It's a fact, and the facts are facts forever, okay? They're forever true right this moment, starting right this moment, right? It's not like we need to wait for them to be true. It's not like we need to do a little dance to make them true. But we're so used to doing these inducement dances that we think that everything can only be induced by our inducement dance. Like, hey, I'm with this body, and I'm living here in this world, and I'm, you know, that kind of thing. But no, facts are facts. Have always been facts. They have nothing to do with our inducement dances. But we're so used to that, we can't just dispense at this instant, pragmatically, with believing in inducement. So it's sort of like we have to sort of still be dualistic here, okay? We're still in an intermediate step, even though this is a very direct step, very direct approach to the new way. It's still intermediate. You have to understand this. Jesus knows this very well. It's like healed perception we're going towards. Because, again, we have been trying to induce the absence, the presence of the absence of intrinsicness for to such an extent, to such a creative extent, that to jettison any sense of inducement at all forevermore, and to believe that we can experience reality without an inducement dance is really just too shocking for us, you know, to directly do that. Although some of you might be able to do that. It's possible. We certainly can do this. Pragmatically, we have to go a little slower and sort of ease our way into that. So the new way still is an easement way. Okay, it's still an easement way. We're not saying try and jettison that at all. Otherwise, you will get too jittery for sure. The wheels will come off. Unless you're a very rare anomaly. But again, we don't use rare anomalies as the standard for the rest of us, that would be absurd. And Sri Sri Anandamayi said that, don't use me as the standard, okay, for what you should aim at. She said, I'm a rare anomaly, an avatara, never having any karma at all. So she said, then the super rare anomaly, so don't try to make that the standard for what your objective is. It's a little beyond your reach. Okay, it's a little beyond your reach. So she's very, very clear about that. So we're in this easement phase. We're easing into this very direct approach of devaluing the I. So what we're saying is, even if we could induce it, and of course we believe we can, we still believe we can, the echoes of that are still there, right? It's still pr and it's present everywhere in this world, that, so it's reinforced to such an extent that the it's echoing in us constantly. Even if we could induce it, it's worthless. It's worthless. I can't do anything. So even if we could induce it, it would be absolutely worthless to us. There's no, I can't do anything. I can't do anything. I can't do anything, meaning even if there was an I, it couldn't do anything at all for us. It has no value. So we're devaluing the I. We're acting as if this is a as if even if there was an I, it would be worthless to us. Okay, so that's an intermediate step. It's not directly saying there is no I. Okay, that would be, it's possible to do that, but it might be too abrupt for most of us. So we sort of, the new way is to, new way is of course to try and help many. So we're saying, even if there was an I, it would be completely worthless. In other words, we're working on devaluing the very notion of an I. And once we get very comfortable with accepting, even if there was, it would have absolutely no value to us whatsoever, then it would be possible to take the next step of realizing, well, it's completely impossible, and I'm going to have not even, I'm going to drop all notion of inducement altogether. That you might say would be the final step. And so Jesus is aiming for this intermediate step, this intermediate step. Always has. And so, but this aim here is very direct, very, very direct and fast. And really, I have not heard of this step previously in history. I'm sure it's been used in certain situations between a guru and a very advanced devotees or something like that, right? But it's not really been given out as dogma throughout the world, really. This is the way. So it seems very, very amazing to simply directly say, I can't do anything. I have no value whatsoever. I have no value whatsoever. Just to say that is revolutionary, actually. I have no value whatsoever. Now, keep in mind, this is not nihilism, because this is a practice. It's not a philosophy. It's a practice. So we're not nihilistic. We're very clear about what we're doing. We're saying even if there was an I, it wouldn't have any value for us. And we understand that we're trying to induce the I, meaning the presence of the absence of intrinsicness, to prove that we're greater than God, and that we can create ourselves, and that we're separate, have a separate creation from God. So we understand the context. So it's not nihilism at all. Not at all. Nihilism is, of course, the philosophy that the world is absolutely meaningless, has no value, no meaning, never will, nothing. It's pointless. The whole thing's pointless. Well, the philosophy is almost correct, but it should have been put into a practice, okay, in the right context. So the problem with nihilism, it's not put in the right context as a practice, but so we have it in the right context there, which is what Jesus has helped us with so much. And the Dharma kings. Yeah, the attempt to induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness is pointless, it's meaningless, it's futile, it will never work. That is absolutely true. So nihilism is pointing to the truth, but not understanding the necessity of disciplined practice. So nihilism does lead to depression. It does. I went through that. I said, my gosh, classical music didn't work. So everything's meaningless. It's pointless. You know, it's sort of nihilism was what happens when your attempt to induce the I doesn't work. And then you just say, well, it's all pointless. It's all meaningless. And you just go into this deep, 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 deep depression. So I've been through all that. And Jesus pulled me out of it by saying, yeah, okay, you're right, but you can't directly realize this because you're so used to inducement that you're going to keep on doing it and believing it. It's just you believe that it's futile. So you believe that your life, you have to do it, but it's just futile. I'm living this futile life, and it's just horrible. He said, no, you can change your purpose and make your life super meaningful by this disciplined practice and understanding the context of the whole situation, that you're easing yourself past your expectations and habits. And so I came out of the depression. I came out of the nihilistic depression because of Jesus' help. And I'm certainly not in a nihilistic depression at all anymore. So it's wonderful that we have the clarity, the overall clarity now about, oh yeah, okay, sure, it's futile. But we're honoring our creativity, aren't we? Because we've been very creative about the inducement dances, and we're not judging ourselves in a negative way. We're just saying factually, sure, it's impossible, but it's okay if we want to keep dancing, you know? And we can even keep dancing without any purpose of induction, just for the beauty of it, the joy of it, right? We don't have to bring it all to an end. Not really. We may choose to do much more beautiful dance, right? We may, you know, be dancing through lotus ponds, for instance. But there's an overall clarity about it all. And there's no depression about it, because we know how to get free of it. And we know that the familiarity problem is an extremely severe problem. The nihilists don't know, they just don't know what to do about it. They say, yeah, it's all pointless, it's all meaningless, it's all futile. And they stop there. So I reached the very bottom of that, and then I realized, wow, I can't stay on the bottom. You know, there's nowhere to go but up. But how do I do that? I don't know. I asked for help, and the Holy Spirit showed up and says, yeah, I know exactly. Holy Spirit says, there is a way to do it, and we will do it for sure, for sure. And that's exactly what has taken place. So we certainly don't want to become, you know, go from nihilism to hedonism, which is what the world tends to oscillate between nihilism and hedonism. And we certainly don't want to be caught up in that oscillation, and we're not caught up in it. Now, we're not saying, you know, that we cannot have some enjoyment in the dance. Yeah, it's like, so yeah, I went out and played golf. I said, okay, God, you want me to? I don't really want to. I didn't want to. I said, what's the point of it? I was kind of a little bit like, well, yeah, but it's, you know, it's really not going to do anything. But I said, yeah, if you want me to, sure, I will. So I follow the grace of God rather than a nihilistic attitude, right? And then, because I realized there's going to be some benefit, I just don't see it exactly. And there was. And it's still, you know, it's so abstract that it's difficult to pinpoint. But what it did was, is it made, it helped me see that you don't have to stop dancing entirely. And in fact, you will be dancing just for the joy of it in the glory of reality. And here's a more beautiful dance, you see. You don't have to keep dancing the way the world is dancing. But you don't have to deviate from it entirely. You know, it's sort of like this easement. You know, let's ease into glory. Let's ease into it. There's a way to ease into it. And of course, the golf is just an excuse to go to these places, a lot of lavish attention is put on some of the better golf courses to make you feel like you're in a different world, actually. And but also that you're free of this world. You're free of it. It's not like Disneyland where there's all these people around. I mean, you're out there and you don't see anybody else. I mean, I didn't see anybody else at all out there. I was with a foursome, and we went off at 6 early in the morning, crack of dawn, and there wasn't anybody ahead of us at all, and we didn't see anybody behind us at all. It's like we had this place totally to ourselves. You know, a billionaire would be fortunate to even have such access to such a place. It was just, you know, just a gorgeous park-like atmosphere of beautiful rocks and waterfalls and pools and lakes and luscious green lawns and just wildflowers everywhere and gorgeous palm trees and all sorts of trees, flowering trees, and just, you know, it's like paradise, like Shabal Gardens that Nanda Mai Ma spent many years in. just stupendously gorgeous. And yet we had it all to ourselves. There's nobody there. No pressure on us to do anything whatsoever. We're just laughing and having a wonderful time. And so, you know, that experience is almost out of this world. And so golf is just an excuse to be able to get that type of experience. And yet the amenities were close by. All amenities were within easy reach. Beverage cart came along, and I got some electrolyte water, actually. Yeah. So, and you could get snacks, you know, anything, you know, the amenities are there. It's not like you're out in the middle of the wilderness and you might die or something. All the amenities are close at hand. So it's a very, very comfortable feeling. And we're not risking our necks, you know, climbing El Capitan or something. It's very safe, very secure, very comfortable, all amenities, all of that stuff. And yet, it felt like we're in a different world here. And, you know, that experience will stay with me, you know, rest of my life. These certain experiences, you know, unforgettable experience. It was so wonderful and beautiful. And I had many of that kind of experiences in this like 5-day period, like that were just drop, you know, just stop in your tracks, beautiful. Just stop in that the morning when I went out early in the morning, it was still dark. It was barely the crack of dawn, and seeing all these palm trees silhouetted dark against this lightning sky, they all looked dark, like some unbelievable painting by some master, you know. It's just you couldn't even imagine. And then the crescent moon with Venus there right close to it, and all the birds just singing in the, you know, it was just beautiful beyond description. And it stopped me in my tracks in almost like an awe. And yet all the amenities were right there. See, I wasn't out in some isolated place. So there was no sense of isolation. Hardly. But neither was there a sense of crowdedness, the world impinging upon it. It was a gated community, so you know, high security, so you can't just, you know, get in there. The people get in there, they're checked security wise. And so you're not going to be impinged, I mean, upon by the world in a disruptive way. Let's put it this way: this disruptiveness is not allowed there. And everyone there is very, you might say, quiet and low key. And it's just the way that it is. You know, you're not disruptive, and actually you can't take pictures or video there, at least commercially. I didn't even have my cameras there. And it's frowned upon because people are there, you know, they don't want people all taking, you know, pictures, and it's not part of the what goes on. So that's great. People feel very relaxed, like this is not going to be a circus, right? Not going to turn this into a circus. And so I went along with it, and it was fine. And if I had my video, I would have taken video of that sunrise, right? Oh. But instead, I just experienced it directly, the whole thing directly. I didn't divert myself into imagery. It's very important that when you come across the sublime now, is perhaps consider not taking any pictures of it. Now, see, you don't need to take pictures on my behalf because I have access to experiencing it directly. You see how important that is? It is. So I'm not asking anybody, oh, can you take a picture of the Grand Canyon at dawn for me? Or can you do this or this or that? I'm having experiences that are extremely sublime for myself. I don't really need someone to take pictures of it. And so this gives you permission to not take pictures, not get diverted into imagery. And you may find yourself then having even greater experiences. I tell you, the experiences I had were more beautiful than any I've ever had before. And I had no video camera or still camera with me on the trip. I didn't bring it at all. There was no way for me to take any pictures, which was, again, one of the most important and difficult decisions of my life, because I had a feeling this great beauty was going to happen, and it did. And I didn't document it at all. So that was like the key decision. Maybe in my life, because my whole life, if I had cameras with me documenting, oh, I see something beautiful, let me share it with everybody. But at this point, what we want to share is not taking pictures of it and allowing yourself the freedom to experience it and trust that you're going to have this all the time. This is the norm. And if it's the norm, why are we taking pictures of it? And everyone else with you is also going to be experiencing this. So you don't need to take pictures. Say, hey, look at this. They say, what are you talking about? I'm here. I'm directly experiencing it. And it's better than any imagery can possibly give me. Because I realize any picture I take, it's not going to be as good as this experience. It's going to be damning it with faint praise, for sure. Because it misses the tapestry, the experience, this vast tapestry, that it's all here for me. It's the context. The context gets narrowed down when you take imagery, even videos. It gets narrowed down. It's not as good at all. Now you can juice it up, make it surreal. I understand that, and there's something to be said for that. Okay, but to be there and directly experience it is more profound and powerful. And what we're aiming for is that those that we will be associating with, we don't need to give them pictures. They're experiencing it. They're experiencing the peace of it. So I don't need to like to go to the place that we were at and go to the people and say, hey, and show them a picture. Hey, look at this great picture. You know, look how peaceful this picture is. They say, what are you talking about? We're here. We're experiencing the peace of it, you know? You seem like an idiot if you do that. So it was kind of like getting ready to be with others who are also so blessed and so fortunate to be experiencing something really wonderful and sublime, and accept that they're on the same level as you. They're also experiencing this. You're not on some higher level than them. There was a bighorn sheep walking down the street. I call them the gardeners. And they were literally, they'd stop at every residence and nibble on all the shrubs. And really, they were manicuring them, trimming them. And they'd stay for just a short while, and then they'd move on to the next yard. I was like, suddenly I heard clack, 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 clack. I look, what's going on? And all these bighorn sheep are walking down the street. I said, oh my God. This is extraordinary. And then I was leaving and walking down this back down the street, and they were coming back towards me, and there was this big horned sheep right there, and we were just looking at each other. I said, "What do I do? I don't know what I do." I said, "I don't want to walk past them. I might spook them, or you know, but they're not aggressive actually." And then so I just stayed there. Then the big horned sheep just kind of slowly like walked right past me. It was just like 5 feet away or something, right down the middle of the street. He's kind of looking at me like, hello. I said, hello. He's like, hello. They're very docile. And so they continued their, you know, cleaning up, manicuring stuff. And they did that every day. And I didn't take any video of it. I just directly experienced it. If I had a video camera, I would have said, okay, where can I get to take a picture of this? Okay, let me frame this and let me get this and like that. And it would have been a completely different experience. Whereas I immersed myself in it as a living experience for myself. And so what I was doing was I was putting faith in God, saying God is going to bring all those who are ready into this very sublime, wonderful place. And so they will also experience it. I don't need to document it for the unfortunate ones. Okay? Because really the unfortunate ones, they're going into this dance of inducement, and they don't want to be distracted by that really. And this is what I found out. They're so into their dance of inducement that they're not interested in some sublime situation like we're going to have. They're not interested in it. They really aren't. And it's shocking to me. I said, holy cow, I've done so much work to try and interest people in a more sublime situation, but hardly anyone's interested at all, because they're fixated on succeeding in inducing the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. And they're very confident, they feel very confident that they will succeed. So no one's been bad to me in life here. No one has. What they just say is, well, thanks, but we're very confident we're going to succeed. So no thanks at this point. And I say, okay. I say, well, I don't share your confidence that you're going to succeed. that's okay. So I'm okay with that. I guess people feel that I'm not really judging them negatively. So nobody's treated me poorly, hardly anyone, really. And if they did, I probably deserved it. But it's amazing. I've had these sublime experiences, and I try to tell people about, if you go to this place, you can have that sublime experience also. And they never go. They never go. They never go. They just don't go. They don't want it, because they may lose interest in trying to induce the eye, right? They may lose interest in it. They may say it's not very valuable. But they don't want to do that, because their habits of expectations is they feel, I have to do this. I have to do it. That's expectations, and they don't have the discipline and context to work at it. They feel they might fall into nihilism. Which they very well might. So fortunate are the ones who have come out of the pit of despair through disciplined practice and really everyday focus on the high Dharma King teachings, getting the overall context of it all. And then you realize, oh yeah, this is what must be done. This is what must be done. I have this severe familiarity problem. Very, very severe. We all do. So the world is characterized right now by a tremendous number of people in the world right now who are very confident that they're going to be able to induce the presence of the eye through technology. And they're going to go that direction for sure. Yeah, you read this, you know, channeling material. Many say they're channeling Jesus, etc. And I take a look at that occasionally, and to me, they're seeing Jesus as they want to see him, okay? And they're really channeling their own hope that this is what Jesus would say to them. And some of it's really good, but for instance, some say that the world is going to wake up. We're right on this great awakening, and the vast majority of the planet is going to awaken. We're going to have this awakened planet. And, you know, I have to say, I don't see it that way at all. I see just the opposite. I see the planet is not at remotely going to awaken. The planet is full, absolutely chock full of those who are very confident they can induce the presence of the eye, of an eye. Very confident in that. And they are most definitely going to continue to do that. Okay. That's how I see it. So I would say that those who think that there's going to be this great awakening here in this world are still engaged in trying to avoid nihilistic despair, and it's wishful thinking on their part, and they're not disciplined enough, and they don't have a clear enough understanding of the context you know, of the familiarity problem, how severe it is, and how we really have to spend our life gradually, patiently diminishing the grip that the familiarity fear has upon us, the continuity problem, familiarity fear. You know, as we melt our expectations down, there's a backlash, and so we really have to become very expert in practicing the wow practice of stabilizing our expectations once we melt them down. You know, so yeah, we expect wow, and wow is definitely going to happen, and it is happening, and so we're able to stay stable. Otherwise, we easily sink into despair if we transcend our expectations very, very, very intensely. So they're afraid to practice in a way that melts their expectations down. So they keep the expectations of, yeah, you know, that they expect the world is going to be transformed into this beautiful, incredibly great place where we'll all be awakened beings, and this is the new age, and this is going to happen. That's their expectations. And they're not able to go beyond those expectations. They're not able to. But here, we're able to. I don't expect that at all to happen here. I expect there's going to be vast troubles here. There already is, and sinking into a black hole. We most certainly are here, but that doesn't bother me, because I'm able to practice effectively. You see, able to practice effectively, and say, well, I'm not going to sink into that. But I honor those who are. I just understand it's just an induction dance they're doing, in a certain way, very intense way, and they're free to do that. They're free to do that, just as I'm free not to do that. I'm free to dance this dance of familiarity with glory, which starts out with familiarity with the sublime, with the freedom to practice, continue to practice the wow practice, and the new way practice of devaluing the I directly. I'm free to do that, and I will do that. But I give them their freedom, and by giving everyone the freedom, I also give myself freedom. Because I'm part of everyone, you see? By giving all freedom everywhere, I'm also included in that, right? And so as you do that, you're also included in that. So I don't need the world to awaken. I don't need that to meet my expectations. I don't need my expectations met in that way. This is, you know, so it's a very, if it does, great, right? But I don't need it to happen for me to be happy, or for me my path to still be to exactly as I want it to be. I don't need that to happen. The whole world could go to hell, and I would still have this path and still be going into the sublime, and it wouldn't pull me down, because I still would not be judgmental and still be giving freedom to all. So again, it's all just an induction dance, and it's the same. It doesn't matter if it seems hellish or heavenish. If you're trying to induce the presence of the I, it's futile. It's absolutely futile. Equally futile. Equally futile. So there's no reason to go into judgmental mode. But we can go into practice mode of getting accustomed to accepting it's all futile. We can never induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. It's impossible. That will never happen. So we've just been dancing creatively. That's all that's been happening. We've always been intrinsic. We've never left intrinsicness. There's no leaving of intrinsicness. And as Jesus said, if you give freedom to all, people will feel that. And maybe that's what they're feeling. People are very nice to me now. I say, why are they being so nice? I don't understand. Because I can see that they're not practicing, and they're, you know, they're doing a dance of induction and stuff. But they're still very nice to me, because they must feel like deep down or something, that gratitude, like, yeah, we just can't stop dancing yet. But we know you're going to stop that dance. And so we value that. So thank you for that. And thank you for not judging us. Thank you for not judging us. We're just still caught up in this familiarity problem, right? But thanks for pioneering this new way, and we'll get with it at some point. And so I understand they will. They will. Everyone will eventually. And it's okay if they want to delay. a thousand years or a million years, or that's okay. That's okay with me. What else can we do, right? They're going to do it anyway. So you might as well get okay with it. And they won't be any worse for it, right? I mean, they'll come around, and they'll come around beautifully at some point. No question about it. Meanwhile, I'm working on my golf swing, so to speak, really fitness from my back and shoulders, so I can, keep getting out to some beautiful place. Now, I'm not very interested in just playing golf for the sake of playing golf. I don't feel that way anymore. Like if someone said, hey, you want to play golf? I said, nah, what are you playing? No, not really. It's not that beautiful. You don't want to go out to a dog track, a Muni dog track, and bash the ball around. I mean, I'm pretty much over that. I mean, that's kind of a youthful thing. Like, just come on, bigger. Let's go out and smash the ball. For me, no. I'm used to really, really beautiful golf courses now. Really, really beautiful. I asked a friend if he could give me a recommendation, and he did. And I checked it out, and I'm going to play there. He said it's really, really beautiful. And I see he's right. He's right. As someone that I trusted, really, who's aware of really beautiful golf courses, and said, yeah, oh, wow, I haven't played that one. There's a couple more I'd like to play. And so I would like to get out on those. It's for the beauty of it. It's simply for the awe and the sublime beauty of the quietness. See, it's very quiet. There's peaceful out there. There's no roads. There's no houses. There's no cars. You're in this little electric golf cart, and it's quiet. It's so quiet, and it's so peaceful. And yet you're still body, and you're still doing exercise, and you're still talking and having a good time. But it's a different experience. That's how business people get away from business. You know, worldly people do that to get away from the intensity of worldliness. They designed it for that. Actually, most of these courses were built, by business people who realize we got to get away from the business mindset. So it's a way for them to shift gears out of that. It's very helpful for them, actually. But it's also helpful for us to shift gears out of this world. Out of this, when the world is just a dance, this world is just a particular dance of inducement. That's all it is. There are many worlds, actually. There are many different styles of dancing, the dance of inducement. Vast numbers. Okay. This is just one world, which has a particular dance of inducement, and many different, many style variations are taking place here. But it's just one. You might say innumerable. Styles. There's so many different styles of trying to induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. So many styles, because we're so creative. And so when we try to do the impossible and we want to see if we can, we're going to have vast diversity in how we go about that. Vast diversity. And there is vast diversity in this universe. Vast diversity. Some show up in the ETs, for instance. They're just dancing in inducement dances of a very different style. But actually, a lot of the younger generation really is looking at what the inducement dances they're doing. It's more extraterrestrial than it is terrestrial here. They've grown up in a culture that's heavily influenced by extraterrestrials, and they look to me, they look like aliens. It's a very alien culture, and I'm sure they look at me like an alien culture to them. But it's again just different styles of inducement dance is all it is. And so the vastness of our creativity is expressing the great play of samsara or maya, as it's referred to in the East. It's very, very vast and with massive diversity in how we try to induce the presence of the absence of intrinsic spaciousness. Any which way at all, and we keep on dancing, don't we? Doing the shake and the frug and the shimmy and the filly and the slog and the watusi and the twist and the jive and the boogie, and on and on and on, almost infinitely different dances that we're doing. And you see people in the world doing all these, you know, different dances. Say, what in the heck is that? You know, and you get the hip hop stuff and the spinner stuff and the free form stuff and the Grateful Dead concert stuff and the rave stuff and it's like, and then you get the ballroom dancing, right? And people do ballroom, they look at the other stuff, say, that's not dancing. You're not dancing. I say, what do you mean? I'm doing. They say, no, that's not dancing. You know, it's the cha cha, and the two step, and the tango, and the, you know, those are dancing. That's dancing. You're not the waltz. You're not doing dancing. So there's these disagreements about, you know, no, that's not dancing, but it's all attempts to induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. Okay. Anything that has to do with structure is that. Anything that has to do with structure is that. So if you could feel this new way, how empowering it is to you, that this is sort of the flavor and the essence of it, the scent of it, the forgiveness of it all, right? The wide picture, the very wide picture of it all, how it just, it can encompass all different styles, and it's okay. You know, there's no judgment upon that all. It's all the same attempt to do the same thing, but in many, many creative, diverse ways. And we're able to honor the creativity at all. And I do. I mean, I look at all this different cultural stuff that's going on and say, wow, it's very creative. But I don't want to get caught up in it. Thanks. I mean, I appreciate your creativity, everyone's creativity. The younger generations, I appreciate all your creativity. It's spectacular. You know, all the modifications you're doing of your appearance and this thing and the other, and all the graphics and everything. It's very, very creative. And that resonates with me. And I say, that's, you know, I see everyone. I say, you are me. I realize, I say, it seems like everyone I see now, I say, that's me. And that's what I am. And I don't know how to explain it, but instead of judging, I say, no, that's me. I am that too. I am that. This is just an expression, also just an expression of creativity of the one self, that I am the one self along with everyone else. It's hard to explain, but you can experience it. I'm starting to experience that. And at first she goes, wait a minute, is that me? I said, yeah, that's me. That's what I am. But it's just creativity, doing a different dance. That's me doing a different dance. It's kind of startling when you see that. I said, yeah, I've done that dance. So how are they any different than me? They're not any different than me. This spirit doing this dance, it's a very similar dance to what I did. Wow. It's the same. Yes, it's one spirit. I don't know, it's amazing. But we don't have to do all these dances. So just because, you know, we see these dances and stuff, all the dances being done on Facebook, yeah, it's amazing, right? But I said, hey, I want to focus on this dance here, which is dancing into no dance, as far as inducing the, we keep dancing, but we change the purpose of it. Now it's just the beauty of it. The sublimeness of it. There's just the sublimeness of it all without any attempt to induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. It's sort of like intrinsicness decorating intrinsicness, as Longchenpa puts it. He says, that's guru vision. You see, it's just all ornamentation. It's intrinsicness ornamenting intrinsicness with intrinsicness. Beautiful play of ornamentation, but that's all that it is. And that's guru vision. So we're moving into guru vision here. We're moving into guru vision. The new way moves us rapidly into guru vision. So God has told me, race of God said, okay, something more is coming. If I'm willing to introduce this new way, which, so he's kind of bribing me, you might say, in a positive way. He says, look, you know, wasn't that great what I did for you? I said, yeah, it was just, you know, it's straight to the heart. You know, it's just, what can I say? You know how grateful I am. And he says, okay, but there's something even better for you if, you know, you're willing to introduce the new way. And I said, Wow. So I was willing to pay the price, but I did pay a price there. Really paid a price for a week. That was, you know, I got kind of tossed around there by the backlash and the jitters. You know, what, you know, how's everyone going to respond to this? You know, what's the, you know, how's it going to flow and how's it going to move? And, you know, it took, you know, unbelievable amount of confidence to do it. And carrot, you know, hey, there's this really even more sublime experience for you. I got something really great for you. I said, okay, I can't miss that. I cannot miss that. I'll pay whatever price there is. And I did pay quite a price. It seemed to be recovery. You know, recovery will take a little while, maybe, but I'm gathering my nerve here. Whew. And someone told me about these sublime golf courses. Someone else, just right out of the blue, said, oh, my brother went and played these courses. They're unbelievably beautiful. And I looked at, checked it out, and they are. I said, wow, maybe I could go there. But I got to work on my game. It's not quite ready. Not quite ready for that sublimeness. I don't know. It makes me a little nervous. The sublime is really, it is quite an experience, right? It really permeates you. And it takes a lot of will to do it, really. We're much more willing to just stick with where we're at, right? In the familiar. The familiar. So it takes quite a bit to drag us out of our cave. takes quite a bit to drag us out of our cave. But you know, it's possible. It's possible. In the back of my mind, I'm saying, maybe this is the next step. Yeah. Wow. Whew. Kind of scary. Yeah, I'm feeling a wow, shaking, like, wow, that's very intense. But people are doing this. Everyone I talk with seems to be, they're finding sublime experiences. Some friends just got back from Tahoe, and they were just glowing. I said, what's going on? They said, oh, I mean, it's just stupendous. They said, it's as good as it gets. It's as good as it gets. And they're quite wealthy, and they were doing all this wonderful stuff out there at Tahoe. They have a house there. And they really had a time. They said, we didn't want to leave. We did not want to leave. It was so wonderful. And I believe them. I mean, I could just tell the glow on them was really something. All the mountains were still snow-capped, but the weather was just perfect, they said, and just conditions were perfect. It was so gorgeous and scenic. So that's very sublime. If you can make it feel all comfortable up there like that. A lot of people are going to Yosemite now, too many people. But I'll take the experiences I'm having. I mean, I appreciate what they're doing, but it doesn't quite fit in with you know, my cup of tea, but it's all sublime tea, right? So many of us are having these kinds of experiences. I'm not wealthy enough to do it like they do it. In fact, I'm not wealthy at all. So I have to bottom of the barrel it. But I still get it. It's still feasible. And some people, you know, go places where, you know, it just doesn't cost anything at all, right? Maybe they're hiking out in the woods or something like that. And I know people right now who are in places, very sublime places, sailing through gorgeous islands, etc. So I think a lot of us are, you know, based on our economic bracket, whatever, are looking for those experiences right now that help move us towards the sublime. But it's astonishing that I'm at the very bottom of all economic brackets, the very bottom. I mean, I'm virtually penniless, actually. But God still arranged for me to have probably, you know, as sublime as experience as anyone in the world is actually having. I wouldn't trade it. I wouldn't trade it, you know. I know there's a lot going on in the world, but it just was perfect for me. It was perfect for what I wanted. Just perfect. And so this may continue. I don't know how it's going to go. But to feel like you're in a different world, and yet the amenities and everything is safe and comfortable, so, is really helpful. It's really helpful now. Because I tell you that the dance in this world of inducement is getting very frantic indeed, very intense indeed, and becoming very radical indeed, and becoming very abrasively radical indeed. And I've been told that this heads up. And I was driving on the freeway yesterday. I may have said this in a previous video, and this car zoomed and veered to the left and almost smashed straight into the car in the fast lane just at 85, and right in front of me. That would have caused a terrible accident right in front of me, which could have involved me in the accident, definitely, and a chain reaction. People hitting me from behind, too. I would have had to slam on my brakes. It could have been really disastrous. They veered to the left very, very radically. And that's what I took away from it. There's likely to be a very, very abrasive veer to the radical leftism in the world. And in the Bay Area may be, you know, the heart of that. I mean, really, like the 60s here. I mean, it's probably more radical than even then. And it tends to attract radicals. And so if there's a really strong radical movement taking place in the world, back in the 60s, that's what happened. And the Bay Area was the heart of it. And what happened was people from all over the world traveled and started living in the Bay Area, crash pads we call them. People took them in all over the place. And so this Bay Area suddenly became extremely radical, whereas before it wasn't that way. It was very liberal, but it wasn't radical. It was liberal because of you know, a lot of universities here. And the history of San Francisco, etc. A lot of reasons. But it became super radical. And the radicals from all over the world came here because they felt this was the headquarters. This was the heart of the movement. And then they used that to try to spread their radicalism throughout the world. So the Bay Area could most certainly be that again, easily. And I don't want to be here if it's like that again. Because I was here in the 60s, and I really suffered horribly from that, because it really wasn't my cup of tea at all. But I didn't know how to... I didn't have the practice I have now to stabilize myself and keep my focus the way it needs to be. But even though I have that now, as we're warned in scriptures, that the world's going to become so radical that even the saints are in danger of being pulled into it. Meaning even those who are really focused on the right context, the right practice, they're still in danger of being pulled down. It's going to become so radical here. So I'm a little nervous about that. And again, the dynamic is, when you have suddenly a movement that captures the world's attention, which is what happened in the Bay Area, got It got spread throughout the world at that time on what the social media we had back then. It got spread throughout the world, television and word of mouth and pictures, etc. That can happen instantaneously, and every radical in the world, anarchists, whatever, who are doing a certain type of dance, of maybe anarchy or a certain type of dance of induction, thinking that this is the one that will work, and the others who don't go along with this dance are the devils and need to be destroyed. They're going to be aware of that, and they may say, "Hey, let's go to the Bay Area right now," and they may come pouring into the Bay Area. Hundreds of thousands of them. And it may become just this, you know, incredibly intense movement coming out of the Bay Area. And I don't want to be around for that. I've already been through that once. You know, I don't want to go through it again at all. So I'm definitely nervous about that. And of course, you know, they'll try to spiritualize it. The movements always do. To spiritualize it. That's what happened in the 60s. But it's way off base, you know. It's just spirituality. It's not what we have here at all. It's not the new way at all. It's basically saying, look, spirit, this is the right dance of inducement. It will work. So get ready for you know, heaven on earth as the presence of the I here, and just work on spiritualizing the I. We can spiritualize the I. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about the I. It'll be fine. Just spiritualize it. That, of course, is, you know, false teaching. Very false teaching. We know for sure. It's impossible to induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. Completely impossible. So the question of spiritualizing that is completely moot, you know? It can never happen. So they're looking for these spiritual leaders to spiritualize and reassure everyone. Don't worry, once this dance, we have the right dance of induction. Once it takes place, don't worry, everything will be fine, because we got these spiritual leaders saying, yeah, we know how to spiritualize it. Oh, and we'll teach everybody it, and everybody will be great. And we'll have heaven on earth, and problem solved. That's what they did in the 60s. The radicals tried to hook up as many spiritual teachers as they could to reassure everyone, like, no, we're on the right track, and it's going to work. And, of course, we know how that's turned out. the present times is how it's turned out. Same old, same old. That's history. That's what happens. That's what happens. So we're not naive about that anymore. So the danger is also if your spiritual presence, you know, is heavy recruitment, heavy try to recruit you, and that's, you know, that's very much a distraction. I don't want to be recruited. Which my low profile is a blessing. Is a blessing. I wouldn't want to have a high profile right at this moment. Many attempts have already been made to recruit me. Actually, I've had to, you know, lovingly say, not now. Okay, not now. Not, that's not what I'm doing right now. But there've been actually many attempts, subtle, you know, for the most part, but definitely attempts. I see it right away. So, oh, there comes another attempt. And there are gurus in the world, or so-called, you know, teachers that have been recruited and are all set up to be, you know, these kingpins of this radical movement, a particular style of dance of induction. And they're, you know, you can see that they're already, you know, very much into it. And they talk a good non-dual game. That's part of it. You have to be able to give the rhetoric, non-dual rhetoric, really convincingly, so to speak. But obviously, we've backed off of that, you know, backed off of it, and anyone can do that, right? Here, it's much, much more focused, okay? With our whole perspective is so wonderful, thanks to the Dharma Kings. We're not stuck in the dogma, non-dual dogma. We're not stuck in it. It's wider than the rhetoric, okay? We're very clear of the context here. And so we're way better off than we were, say, 50 years ago. Way better off. Hey, my phone's actually ringing now. It's actually working. Let's see. One moment, please. Yes, hi. Thank you. Appreciate it. And my phone is ringing now. Thank goodness. Isn't that great? And I can hear you plainly. So everything, the phone is working perfectly now. That is great. Amazing. Yeah. Great. Thank you. Okay. All right. Talk to you later. Bye. Wow, that's amazing. I spilled this goo gone on my phone and it stopped working. And that was 2 days ago. And suddenly it's working again now. It's ringing. I can hear someone. That's amazing. I kept the faith. I said, I'm not going to throw it away. You know what? Everyone said immediately, go get a smartphone. Oh, your phone's broken. Great. I'll get you a smartphone. That's the first thing they all said. I said, no. Just wait. I want to wait. Look what happened. It's working perfectly again. It's working perfectly again. You see how patience is so important and keeping your faith is so important. So really, you know, so much gratitude to Jesus for really pioneering the way with A Course in Miracles. That was really a pioneering work that he did. And he did that knowing the times that we're going into, right? And you know, a lot of us really got hammered in the 60s and the 70s. Just got hammered. And this Course in Miracles lifted us up, lifted me up out of that. No doubt about it. And it just opened up this perspective upon forgiveness. You know, his focus on forgiveness and how we can get to that and how we can have such a supremely tolerant attitude without having also upon ourselves. You see, this is what he emphasizes. He says, give freedom to all, and you're giving freedom to yourself too. And you don't have to do what others are doing, but it's not judgmental. It's just, you know, you have the right to dance in your way, he says. You have the right to experience your flow also. And that's, you know, so just the tone that he sets, the lifts us all up somehow, past all the words. And Tom Carpenter asked Jesus in Dialogue on Awakening, are you coming back? And Jesus says, now. You know, he sort of said, hey, wait a minute. He said, look, I don't have any plans. He says, but look, give me the freedom also. Let me also have the freedom that I'm saying, I'm giving you freedom. Realize that I'm also giving myself freedom. So I'm also free to do what I want to do. You know, so it's like, it's amazing, amazing. I always remember that response that Jesus had. He's saying freedom means freedom for all of us, including me. I'm not bound, you know, to some plan. I don't function according to plans, he said. I'm free. I want to make that very clear. I am free. If I come back, it's just my dance of freedom according to the compassion of the one mind. But I stay in the now. Jesus saying, I stay in the now. I am dancing in the now. So I'm not saying I'm not coming back. I'm not saying I am. He said, I don't have any plans. But what he's saying is, I don't function according to plans. Now, he may be aware that he might be doing something at some level. I don't know how it works exactly. But he just trusts, complete trust in God, such that he knows that whatever is appropriate, he will do what's appropriate. So he doesn't plan. He allows himself the freedom of the flow of the one mind. And he is back. He is back. But, you know, just the way he's done it is he's still just in the flow of freedom. And so he's showing that we can be that way too, and you don't lose compassion or helpfulness by being that way. You don't have to rigidly lock yourself into some structure. And he tries to tell us, don't plan. He says, don't plan. In fact, don't. You can be in this world, he says, you don't even plan the next instant. And I'm pretty much that way. I really don't plan, hardly at all. Occasionally, the Holy Spirit will say, okay, you need to get ready for something. I'm not going to say what it is, but just stay in the flow of what you're doing. But, you know, get in shape, or, you know, keep your good habits going, or something like that. But I really don't plan hardly at all. And when I do, it feels very odd. I don't plan these videos, what I'm going to say. I don't plan what I'm going to do next after this video. I'm just present. I'm just, and whatever arises, okay, I just be present with that. And see, Jesus didn't want to lock us into expectations of his return either. He wanted us to keep flowing with our freedom so we get more and more used to it. So if he said, yes, I'm coming back, this is how it's going to work, he's locking us into some plan, right? So he didn't want to lock us into any plan, like, yeah, I'm returning. But he didn't say he wasn't. He didn't say, no, I'm not. I'm definitely not returning. He didn't say that. He just said vaguely, I have no plans, you know. So I got the gist. I said, okay, this is, he doesn't want us to be locked into something. But when he returns, he'll say, okay, he did. Like a little over a year ago, he said, I'm back. And I'm back here to relate with you as a friend. And you as friends. I'm relating with you as friends, and I want you to relate with me as I'm your friend. Just as a friend. Just as a friend. And then he showed up last week through this open door, and I could see the freedom that he was coming from, just absolute formless freedom and presence. And he is willing to say, to take on some, let me relate with that here in this world of seeming form and seeming structure, but didn't say a word. He's just observing everything. I saw it. He was aware of everything. He's just aware. He says, focusing in on, say, okay, I'm just aware of all this, okay. I'm present here. But no need to say anything. No need to say anything. So I allowed him to have that freedom. And I didn't say, well, stay here. And I felt that he went back out that door, you know, that open door, so to speak, that his presence never left it, actually. So I'm okay with that. You know, just say, okay, let it be that way. That's fine. We'll get the inspiration, and we have got the inspiration. So we're giving some context here to this practice of, and this practice just can be worked in daily, and I do work it in daily. Whenever I feel like it, I can just suddenly go very powerfully and devalue the I. Like, I can't do anything. I can't do anything. I can't do anything at all. I can't do anything at all. I'm completely useless. I'm completely useless. I'm completely useless. But don't overdo this. You'll have time next hour and tomorrow to keep doing this. And it's so powerful. I don't believe you have to do a whole lot of it to be effective. It is so powerful. Just saying those a couple times like that, I could feel it just wham. Really strong reaction. I'm completely useless. I'm completely useless. I'll always be completely useless. I have no hope whatsoever to be of any use whatsoever. I have no hope to be of any use whatsoever. Wow, isn't that great? Now a nihilist will be feeling this like, but not know what to do about it. But for here, and be depressed. Here, I'm feeling like elated to hear this. I says, that's great. That's exactly the right approach to devalue the I, so we can drop our expectations that we keep dancing to try to induce it. We can do a different style of dance that's not an induction thing. It's not a form-based time process, time-space process and form-based type of dream type of pretense. Don't really need that. Don't need it. Because that's what we feel will induce the I. It has to have some structure to induce it. It has to have some time-space process and form. Whereas if we drop trying to induce the I, we'll keep on dancing, but it'll be the dance of formless essence, which is what reality really is. And we'll will realize we are the intrinsicness. All is the intrinsicness. And so, as Jesus says, that's glory. And we cannot imagine what that's like, so we should not even try to imagine it. But we just have to move, trend in that direction. This is a modification of the Power C machine. I put in some chocolate, a chocolate protein drink, Odwalla chocolate protein drink. Mix the two up. Tastes great. Tastes great. That's my breakfast. For now. I don't know, I'm not into starving myself right at the moment. I think when you go through these jitters, you kind of like feel like you want to... It's too much to try and starve yourself at the same time. Like when I had the flu, I actually ate a lot. I felt like, oh, it's a great opportunity. I can lose like 5 more pounds and get really thin. I said, no. You know, feed the flu. So I fed it, and it worked out great. And that flu was really the fear of this new way expressing itself. I said, boy, I don't know if I'm ready for this. Maybe I should miss it. And so I had to work really intensely to get past that flu and thank it for coming, but say, no, I think I'm going to give it my best shot. And I said, I'll try the best I can. And then from that point, I was able to prepare for this new way, to pioneer this new way. And it really is a new way, because really you have the power now in power, you see. We're empowering you, all of you, with this practice. That it's okay to directly devalue the I. And you just can do it. You can say, I'm useless. I'm absolutely useless. I have no hope of ever being useful at all. You see, anyone can say that. So it's devaluing the role of the guru, the teacher, in a lot of ways, by empowering all of you. You can do this directly. It's so easy. It's so easy, right? I mean, so how am I any better than you? You can do the same practice, right? You can do the same practice, just like I'm doing it. I'll never amount to anything. I'm completely worthless. I have no value whatsoever. I have absolutely no value. I'll never have any value. You could do the exact same practice and experience the exact same results. So I'm, you know, willing to give that out to everybody, meaning I you know, it's empowerment to everyone. But I know that that's for the best, right? The more empowered you are, the more you're trending towards glory and the sublime, which and giving permission for everyone else to have that means you'll give the permission back to me for me to also experience that. The more you experience the sublime, the more you feel like giving permission to others. But you also have to be pragmatic about it. If there's some place that is just right for you, you don't have to say exactly where that place is, because you get curiosity seekers who think, oh, if it's good for you, it must be good for me, and they don't understand the whole premise of all this. No, what's good for me may not be your cup of tea. They may have many cups of tea. You need to have your cup of tea that's right for you. So what's sublime for you, maybe that may be just your cup of tea. And my cup of tea may be playing golf someplace. You know, that's not your cup of tea, all right? So there's no reason for me to say, yeah, this is where I am. And I try to attract people, you know, to where I am. That's not where it's at. It's not where it's at. God's grace of God said, no, don't do that. Don't do that. You just attract the gullible and the sensational seekers and the curious and the overly enthusiastic and all these types who don't understand the context of what's going on at all. Okay, they're sort of sensation seekers, so to speak. Don't want that. We don't want that. So you don't have to say where you are or where you're experiencing the sublime. You don't have to say that. You don't have to tell others that. But what's important is that you do that. And when you do that, you will feel more comfortable with it, and then you'll have this feeling of giving permission to everyone else. Say, yeah, do it, do it, do it, do it, and you won't feel like you're being left behind or being shortchanged or anything like that. And yeah, right? It's like that. So rather try to empower others. Say, yeah, find your place, your refuge, your sublime experiencing. Find that, what's great for you. And these videos are still here to encourage everyone to do this and to help reassure everyone about the new way. And yet you can empower yourself so easily now by just doing this practice. Directly devalue the I in your expectations. I have no value at all. So your expectations are now being reshaped to not value the I, even if we could. It's valueless anyway, so why even bother anymore to try and induce it, right? Induce the presence of the absence of intrinsicness. Why even bother? Not really interested anymore. That kind of. So it's so simple. It's so simple and so empowering at this point. We don't need these massive books anymore. We don't need these massive books. Now, as a lot of people maybe hopefully repent, the first step may be a massive book like A Course in Miracles to get them on track, lift them out of their oscillations. But we don't need that. Those who wrote the New Way, we don't need some massive book at this point. We just need that this practice. I don't have any value at all. I'll never have any value. I will never have even the slightest iota of value. Never. And it doesn't matter whatever dance I do, I'll never have the slightest value. Right. I can't ever amount to anything at all. I can't ever amount to anything at all. I can't even take the first step out of futility. I can't even take the first step out of futility. I'm intrinsically futile. I am intrinsically futile. How about that? I am intrinsically futile. So you can just work with this and be aware of how it shocks you. It's like shock treatment to your expectations. And how you have to then, you know, be skilled in the wow practice. Say, but I still have this expectation and it's being met by wow. Yeah, my expectations are being met because my expectation is wow. I'm happy with that. That's all I need. And it's right here. So when your expectations aren't being met, in terms of devaluing the I, make sure your expectations are being met by the presence of the wow. So you're not all freaked out, say, oh my God, my expectations are not being met in any way, I don't know how to function. You said, no, 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 they're being met. They're being met by the wow. Everything's fine. I'm fine. All is great. Trust in the Holy Spirit to lead you to the place that's your cup of tea, which is what I do. So I don't say where I am or where I'm going. Because it's not about me at all, is it? It's about the practice. It's about your practice. You're the guru of your practice. You really are the guru of your practice. It's not about me. So you don't need to seek me out and find me. Where are you? What are you doing? You know, it's where are you at? What are you doing? You know, what's your cup of tea? Because the practice has been given out here. So just do it. And then follow the inner grace that you have, the guidance that you have from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's the super guru, okay? That's our teacher, really, the Holy Spirit, the grace of God orchestrating your path in a unique way because your dance of inducement has been unique. All dances of inducement I mean, all of us have unique history of our dances of inducement, because the diversity, since it doesn't work, we keep trying different ways. We're so creative. No two of us are totally alike at all. No two of us are alike in terms of our expectations. Okay, we all have slightly differing expectations. Sometimes we have very differing expectations, but there's no two expectations that align perfectly at all. So, you are the guru, and the super guru is the Holy Spirit, so to speak, the grace of God, that informs you, the guru, of your own practice. You know, where to go, what to say, what to do. But wherever you go, you can practice very simply. The I, whenever the I comes up, just say, oh, I am completely futile. I dwell in absolute futility forever. I dwell in absolute futility forever. And that, you know, severely devalues the I, doesn't it? Say, wait a minute, do I really want to induce the I when the I dwells in futility forever? So maybe I don't want to induce it, you know? Maybe I better back away from that attempt. Maybe I better not even bother attempting it so much. So how many times do we use the I during the day? You know, so many, right? In our thinking, in our speech, whatever. So easily to remember this practice. It's so simple. And it doesn't need to be complex. You can say, I don't have any value at all. It can be, you can just use one form of it if you want. But being that we're creative and diverse, we may use quite a few different formulations of it, right? But it's all play on just, I don't have any value. I doesn't have any value whatsoever. None. Never will have, I will never have even the slightest value. Totally valueless. Even absurdity has no value. I'll never have any value at all. I will never have any value at all. Wow. So then bring the wow in, meaning my expectations are being met because I'm feeling the wow. And I expect to feel the wow. So go into your practice every day expecting to feel the wow. And then the meltdown of your expectations concerning the value of I won't bother you so much. You won't panic. And say, yeah, I'm losing one hope, but that's okay. My expectations, I'm still getting what I expect, which is the wow. So I'm not getting what I expect with the I, but I am getting what I expect with the wow. So I'm fine. I feel fine. No panic. No panic here. But I had to battle through the last week, and I was getting into repetitive songs going through my head. And when that happens, I know I'm in panic mode. So I had to really, really, really struggle with that. And was really kind of lost track of the wow practice, the clarity about it, kind of lost track of it. That's how intense it was. Now it's coming back. But I had to work at it to get it back. But we've got it back now. So If you go through this experience, you might feel initially like a week or so. You might feel like, wow, it's a transitional thing, and it's like an amusement ride, and you're going through the scary part. It's like, oh my gosh, I didn't know it was going to be this scary. But you know, if you keep staying on the tracks, you'll come out of that scary part of the ride. And then it's like, this is the great part of the ride. So just say, okay, baby, okay, I'm in panic a little bit. And you can watch these videos, and they should reassure you. Like, oh yeah, let's get back to the wow. What is the wow? Okay, yeah, now we know. We expect, they say, we intentionally, with our will, says, I expect to experience the wow. That's the ultimate expectation I have. And so since I'm experiencing the wow, which is kind of the shock of devaluing the I say, oh yeah, well, that's okay that I'm not getting what I expect here, because I'm getting the ultimate expectation, which is even better, which is this wow. So it's kind of like I'm trading one expectation for another, but the one I'm getting is the ultimate. It's the best. So why should I panic? I'm fine. I'm getting even something even better. So I'm waiting for another golf club to arrive. Yeah, I'm really excited about that. It's going to maybe get me out. Again, I don't know. I don't feel like getting out in Northern California. I've been around to the various places. I don't know. Maybe I will. Right now, I don't have the money. I really, literally don't have the money for it. Even a round of golf. am having to get help just to even, you know, get survive, actually. But, you know, God, I just trust that God will somehow, it'll, things will ease up in some way, and yeah, I might be able to get out, I don't know. But Northern California, I'm kind of used to it, you know, it's just like, I want something that's different. There's something about something that's really different that kind of shifts your whole expectation, right? Like, oh my gosh, I didn't know a place like this even existed. This is amazing, like that. I didn't know anything could be so sublime. You get so used to where you're living. I've lived in this area my whole life, and really, the truth is that if you're coming to this area for the first time, you would think it's very sublime. Just the trees in the south, in the Bay Area, you know, the amount of trees it's just stunning. You know, it's just so many plants and trees here, and if you're used to like a stark area, or you know, like, and you come to this area, I can understand you would think it's just unbelievably beautiful. But I'm so used to it. I now, to me, stark areas are beautiful. It's so stark. Oh, this is amazing. Look at the stones. I can see them so clearly. Here, you know, everything is just trees, 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 shrubbery, shrubbery, shrubbery. You know, you're just like driving through like Atherton or something, and it's just, you don't even see any houses. You just see unbelievable amounts of luscious tree growth everywhere. And yeah, if you hadn't experienced that like this, it would feel like heaven almost here. But it doesn't feel like heaven to me anymore, you know. I just say, my God, I'm so tired of all these trees. I kind of like seeing areas with like, a, you know, lesser trees, a few palm trees just here and there. And then the sky, I think, oh, that's so beautiful. Just its simplicity, you know, less is more kind of thing. It's almost like there's too many trees here. You're like just, yeah, I mean, like Palo Alto, you drive through the streets. It's just, you're like under this canopy of trees everywhere. It's so beautiful. There's no doubt about it. You get so used to it. And you say, oh yeah, I've seen this a million times. Yeah. Isn't there something else? It's difficult to still, you know, get that buzz from it, right? Give me an oasis with a jeweled sky of stars and stark desert and just a few beautiful, majestic palm trees. And you just say, oh my gosh. Throwing shade and sitting in the shade, and it's, you know, very different, very contrasty to what you're used to. So sometimes getting out of what you're used to really gives you a jolt. So some of my frustration, Barry, at least, is that I'm just so used to it. My whole life I've spent here, with hardly ever being anyplace else. Just a few days here and a few days there. Otherwise, every single day has just been here, the same place. Driven down the same road, you know. Whew, you know, so many times, just uncountable times. And it's just like, oh, yeah, I know. Oh, there's a crack on the sidewalk. Oh, that's interesting. Trying to find something that's different, you know, that I'm not used to. And, you know, this is blooming so beautifully. Oh, yeah, but I've seen it bloom, you know, every year for 60 years. And the clouds and the day, you know, it's so gorgeous, but I'm so used to that gorgeousness. Yeah. Isn't it gorgeous somewhere else? God, isn't it gorgeous somewhere else? I like a little diversity of experiencing. So here, I kind of have to use a camera and video because I'm trying to get something else out of it I haven't gotten. Whereas I go somewhere else, I really feel like, oh my gosh, I don't really, everything's like a picture, just it's just amazing. It's so different, it's so beautiful, it's so amazing, beautiful. And that's why people, of course, travel. It keeps everything fresh, everything seems beautiful to them. But that's not a substitute for the right practice. You know, so staying in the same place here has kind of forced me into focusing on what's really important, which is the context of right practice. Whereas others who go gallivanting all the time, they never get to that. They just think, well, I gotta pick up and go and let's go fly to Hawaii, you know, and stay in Hawaii a little while. Oh, I got a friend over in Japan, let's go to Japan. And then the next thing you know, they're in India. And then they're in Sri Lanka. And then they're in Bali. And then they're, you know, in Spain. And then they're, you know, back in the desert. And then they're up here, the Bay Area. And then they're and it just never stops like that. Down in Newport Beach, up in Tahoe. They have to do this just to keep their hopes alive that I has value, that their dance of inducement will have value. But staying in one place like this, it was so boring that I had to find interest in ideas. And in doing that, then I've been able to get to this point of the new way now of seeing how we can literally practice devaluing the very notion of the I. Even if we could succeed, we don't really want to. Right? Even if we could. Yes, we can't, but our expectations are that we can. So let's devalue our expectations that like, but the I is completely useless. I is totally worthless. Wow. I can't do anything. The I can't change anything. The I can't get any better at all. The I can't improve. I can't improve my life at all. I can't improve my health at all. I can't improve my situation at all. I can't do anything at all. I can't even work. I can't even find good work, any work at all. I'm useless. I have no value. You keep repeating that and you know, that's very, very profoundly helpful, more helpful than gallivanting about the world. Now, surfers gallivant about the world, so that's a great, I checked in with them and you realize, hey, you know, they're just still caught up in creatureness, trying to induce the eye. And they go to the most beautiful places in the world, these surfers. Tavaru and Fiji, it's just, you know, just gorgeous. Like, it's just paradise. And then they're, you know, in Hawaii, they're in South Africa. They travel all over the world. And are they, you know, liberated? No. They're kind of just like, you know, creatureness. It doesn't do it for them because they're not devaluing the, you know, doing the right spiritual practice. There's nothing that makes me more nervous than golf. I don't want to play because you never know. I mean, you're going to play lousy, basically. So, I'm not quite ready. I'm never ready. And so I kind of always hope, like, I hope I get with some guys that also kind of play in the same way, you know, and I always, almost always do. And you can kind of relax, say, nope, nobody's laughing at you. You know, you get some guy, I got some guy down where I was before, and, you know, he swings, mighty swing, and tops the ball, and it rolls like 10 yards. And then his friend laughs, and, you know, is joking him and stuff. And it kind of, I just relaxed at that point. I said, oh, okay. It's okay, you know. We're all in good company here. And then everybody was fine. So it kind of takes somebody like hit a terrible shot and everyone's laughing. And I hit one on I hit one on 18. I joined the party. I just absolutely pulled it left. Through the jungle and through the palm trees. And I was watching. Everyone's watching. What's going to happen? And it hit this huge, majestic palm tree, way far away, gorgeous, majestic. And it hit it dead center, at like, you know, 150 miles an hour. So, pow! You could hear it. And where it ricocheted, nobody knows. Where that ball went, nobody knows. It probably landed in paradise. And I just burst out loud. I said, "Got it." You know, yeah, and they all, and everybody was like shouting and yelling. Said, "You know, what a shot, man! You hit that one perfect, didn't you?" And they were all really psyched up because to hit that palm tree like that perfectly from such a great distance—I mean, that was better than hitting the fairway. So instead of like thinking, oh, what a bad shot. They said, what a great shot that was. And so that really loosened everybody up. It was the final hole. I said, I joined the party. I hit this very wayward shot that turned into the best shot of the day. I said, just let that ball be wherever it is, you know. The surrounding area was so beautiful that wherever it went, that ball's it's a happy golf ball right now. Yeah. Saying, wow, thank you. It's probably thanking me. It's like, oh, you put me in the perfect place. Instead of finishing the round, put me in your golf bag, you left me beneath this palm tree, you know, with this waterfall and beautiful fountain and pools and flowers. And I'm just a little golf ball with a smile on my face. Now, probably a smiley face on that golf ball right now. Saying, yeah, this is what a nice guy, you know. What a nice guy to leave me here. What the grace of God. Sent me to paradise. So that was the grace of God right there. I said, I don't know how I hit that shot. It was meant to be. Showing me, yeah, that palm tree hit it dead center. Everything perfect, perfect, perfect. So you never know what to expect when you play around at golf. You just don't know what's going to happen. It's so up in the air. It's useless to try and orchestrate it. You know, it's useless. You just have to be in good shape and organized enough. But you just don't know what's going to happen. You really don't. Nobody does. Even the pros don't know. They say, no, I don't even know how it's going to go. They said the same thing. He said, I shot 7 under par yesterday, and today I shoot 7 over par. I don't know. I got to the golf course, I felt fine, and then just nothing went right. Or I got to the golf course, and everything went right for me. I can't explain it. It's inexplicable. Just be comfortable, you know, dress well, dress the way you want to dress, and just pray that you meet the right people there. And you really have to just stay in a prayerful mode there. Just really, it helps you with that. Just, I'm very prayerful if I go to a golf course. It's just because theoretically everything can go wrong. Yeah, so, and sometimes, you know, it seems that way. Just pray like I hope I get with the right people and it's the right situation and we get along and, you know, and I played well enough and it's just, I don't, you know, lose my cool and get all rattled and, so I better start praying right now. Yeah, pray ahead of time. Because I'm definitely getting outfitted for something. It's no question about it. It's making me a little nervous. Doesn't matter how well you get outfitted. You never know. But of course, we really don't know what our day is going to be like any day we get up, do we? Whew. I don't have any value at all. I can always say that, can't I? Get to the golf course, first tee. Now on the first tee, Clarity Ross. Okay, well, I can say, wow, I don't have any value at all. And this round of golf is not going to give me any value at all. I'll still be totally worthless when I walk off the 18th green. I'll still be totally worthless. Wow. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? But really, the people you play with are jewels, you know, they're just jewels. I mean, they're just, everybody's just in the same boat, you know, and everybody is so kind to one another out there. Because they know you got the guts to be in the same boat with them, you know, and you're willing to struggle with it too. So yeah, I have no value. I'm completely worthless. And when I walk off the 18th green, I will be just as worthless as I am now. Totally worthless with no value whatsoever. And it takes the pressure off, doesn't it? It takes the pressure off. Maybe you could take the pressure off your day that way. But really, we need to employ this, directly employ it in our lives. It's not just something we do here. We use it. It's to be used to calm yourself down. I'm gonna pour a little water in this smoothie here because it's so thick, and I'll just dilute it and fill the bottle up again, and that's shake it up, and that'll keep me going. And you don't want to, basically, this is just using analogy here. You don't want to like hit a 300-yard perfect drive off the first tee because that shocks everyone. They say, "Uh-oh, we're playing with some really good golfer." They get all nervous. So this isn't going to be any fun because I'm an idiot. You know, they're saying, "I'm an idiot. I look like an idiot." You don't want to do that. Presumably, I'm just presuming this. But, it's best to just maybe hit a nice little two hybrid or something. Hey, 215 yards or something off the first tee and kind of get it in the fairway. And they say, "Ah, nice shot. And it doesn't put the pressure on everybody. And then, later on in the round, start cracking some, and people say, "Ah, nice shot." But they're already relaxed. But on the first tee, everybody's really jittery, like, "Who am I playing with?" They don't know. Well, if you're a single, they don't know. If they're with their friends, they might be already relaxed. But they don't know you. They don't know me. So they're thinking, who's this guy? And I hope he's not too good. And not too much of an idiot either. So if you just absolutely dial it in from the first tee, really, that's probably not the best idea. Let everyone get to know one another first, and be relaxed with one another, and realize that it's. We're in good company here, and all is good. And then maybe you can start, smashing it later on. And I did that, and everyone had a really good time with it, joking and laughing and talking, and got a lot of praise for it too. And I was just like, "Wow, yeah, this is fun." But it didn't cause any tension or anything like that. And people, I say, "Well, we're just out here to have fun," meaning, "Hey, don't play too well. Come on, don't put the pressure on me." Because, if you're not a pro, you don't want the pressure on you, right? You don't want the pressure, no. Because you're bound to, you make a fool out of yourself if you do that at some point. Almost bound to do that. Unless it's going to happen. And people want to be helpful to you, too. So you sort of, they help you out. "Okay, I'll look where your ball's going. Let me help you find it." And this, and it's kind of like a mutual helpfulness we experience out there, too. Because, if you hit your ball and it kind of gets lost, everybody's just looking for it. And you try to help them look for their ball. And so it's camaraderie. Camaraderie, helpfulness, common goal to get through and have a good time and all that. So it brings out the best in us. It brings out the best, actually. Wow. That could have been a problem. The breeze is so strong right now. Holy cow. Huh. Could have had a problem, an accident there. Very strong breeze. Looks like the world is very strong breeze, so we have to lean against it somehow. I had a conversation with one of the men I play golf with, very nice Canadian guy. I've never met a Canadian that isn't really nice, to tell the truth. You know, it's like amazing. I mean, what are they doing up there? It's just astonishing. They seem to be so well adjusted and full of common sense and everything like we think we're supposed to be like. They're like what we're supposed to be like, you know. That maybe they're the real Americans or something. What's going on here with Canada? Anyway, we're talking about the world, and we had exactly the same take on it. We're about similar ages, I think, and same take on what's going on. He said, "It is so weird. What is going on? What in the world is going on? It is so weird." We both, you know, disagree. It was like, wow. And I said, well, at least we're getting away from it. And he said, yeah, the golf, we're just getting away from it, just enjoying it. It's so wonderful. You know, it's just, what a blessing. And we say, I don't know what to make of it. I don't know what to do about it, but to make it, I just have to keep on going. I just can't think about it, you know, how weird it is. Because the dances of induction and trying to induce the eye are so different, you know, so weird to us. So weird, really. So weird. But yeah, we have to be big enough to see what's going on and just say, it's okay, you know. Weird is weird. Yeah, it's weird. I mean, it doesn't match what we're familiar with at all. But to them, those who are doing it, it's not weird. You know, it's normal to them, to the younger generations. This is normal because they come from a place where they're used to this. You know, their previous lives were in a place where this was the type of induction dance that they did there. So they're very used to it. Normal. To them, it's just totally normal. And we're the weirdos. What the heck are they? Those guys doing? They're so weird, the older guys. You know, they can't believe how weird we are. A lot of those in this world right now actually came from. They had lives on other planets, different planets than this one. I was even taken to one of those planets and shown where most of the young people are coming from, this super technological planet. And so for them, roboticism is just completely normal. The fact that we don't have robots here is like completely weird to them. Like, where are all the robots? You know, what the heck is this place? It's totally weird. I can't stand this. I need to make robots quickly. We might need to make it normal so it's what we expect. And for me, like, robots are just completely weird. They're totally weird. Totally weird. I'm not into robots at all. My expectations are just not there at all. So that's how it is right now. Very weird place for everybody. Everyone. The younger generation think, you know, olders are really, really off their rockers. Totally weird. What are you, you know, you can't do that. You know, that's not going the direction we expect. We want things to go the way we expect. And vice versa, right? So we need this practice, the new way. We need this new way practice. Practicing in this new way directly devalue the eye, and that absolutely will smooth us out with the whole situation that we have here. Wow, another really cool breezy day, just like a March day, a day in March, actually. It's like that here. So we're spending time with this as we do in these videos because it's so important. This new way is so vitally important to everyone. To everyone. The beneficial effects of this will reverberate to everyone, ultimately. And the whole universe, actually. It's a universally helpful, what we're doing, universally helpful. To the end of all this inducement dance. We won't call it time because we're just pretending that there's time to try to induce an eye. We know there's no such thing as time, space, process, or form. We're pretending there is to say, look at this nice house, you know, you have eye. Don't you want to move into this house of time, space, process, and form? But deep down we know it's just all now, okay? It's all intrinsicness right now. But so this will reverberate, this new way practice of devaluing the eye directly, will reverberate all the way through all pretension, all dances of an inducement, until ultimately everyone finally has reshaped their expectations and be willing to drop it, that pretense. That's how important it is. That's how important it is to get to this practice directly devaluing the I like this, just directly. I am completely worthless. Wow. I am completely worthless. Wow. I am completely worthless. Wow. But it's okay because my expectations have, you know, the ultimate expectation of wow. I am completely worthless. Wow. So simple, isn't it? So simple. But powerful. Every time I do that, I can feel a shock reaction that quickly. It is that powerful. So don't drink coffee and do this. It'll be too much. It'll be too much. That's why I always stress good habits. Get off the caffeine. Seriously. I know it's very difficult for most of, but it's very important to get off the caffeine. Now, let's say you're a caffeine addict. Okay, you're used to your levels of caffeine. Okay, just take it from there. Okay, don't increase. Don't go to espresso. Don't go to energy drinks. Don't do that. If you're already used to a base level where it just feels normal to you, then stay within that normal. Okay. Stay within that normal because you have to feel the shock of what you state. I mean, I'm telling you, I say, I am completely worthless. I have absolutely no value whatsoever. It just feels like I chugged an espresso or something, you know? My reaction is like I just drank an espresso. I'm like shaking. I'm just like jittery, like, oh my gosh. It's like that. And so you have to be aware of that. And then go into the wow, say, wow, I better back off my practice. But if you're on actual caffeine, this masks the reaction. And so you might do it too much. We don't want you to do this practice too much. Okay. We want you to do it wisely and effectively, not to a stupid level of too much. Like, you know, don't lock yourself in a room and do this for the next 3 days and think you'll walk out enlightened. No, you'll walk out, a mess. It's too much. Don't do too much. I for me, I just say it one time, and it's a jolt. It's a jolt. Just because I'm saying it with conviction, it really jolts me. So you have to feel that jolt and know why, what's going on, and then back off a little bit. And if you're on too much caffeine, if your abnormal levels, let's say, this is going to cause a problem for you for sure. So stay within your norm. If you have, I know a lot of people tell me that they can't get off caffeine. It's a big problem for them. Well, stay within your norm then. Stay within your norm. Because you do get tolerant to it. You get used to it. Stay within your norm. Don't do anything out of your norm in that regard to try and up your practice or something. No. Be humble about your practice. If what you said just gives you a jolt and shocking you, say, okay, that's enough for right now. Wow, let me do the wow practice now. Calm down. Because truly, saying it just once, that's not a sign that you're no good. I mean, for me, I get that jolt just saying it once. That means I'm doing it really, really well with great conviction. And Jesus really tells us that you can say, if you can do a practice, he said, if you do a practice with total conviction, just right, just one time and you're done. It can liberate you just like that. Just once. So it's not how many times we do it. It's the purity of conviction that we do it with. And just the willingness to say, I have no value whatsoever, and just not even think about it. Just let that in completely, straight into the heart of our expectations. This really has a profound effect, a real jolt. All right, very great. This has covered a lot of territory, and we need to cover it. Again, you are part of this new way, and by being part of this new way, you are literally giving compassionate help and encouragement to the entire universe that is dancing this dance of induction forever. I mean, until it's all cleared up. You are literally helping everyone. You're being extremely, extremely helpful. You talk about being part of the solution. You are most definitely being part of the solution in a very, very profound way. So we greatly appreciate, there's great appreciation to everyone that's paying attention to this for the vast help that you are extending to us all. The vast help you're extending to us all. So much gratitude to all of us. Wow.